Hi, my name is Brandon Zarzyczny, but you can call me Big Z, and today I'm talking about Children of Blood and Bone by Tomi Adeyemi. And she is a Nigerian-American writer, and she's also a creative writing coach, and this is her debut novel, and it's a young adult novel, and I originally found out about it because Jimmy Fallon from The Tonight Show was doing this summer reads thing, like a book club, and they had, you know, like five books that they wanted people to vote and choose from, and I went, you know, checked all them all out, and I actually bought two books from that list, and that is, you know, the Shown of Blood and Bone and The Good Son. And the one that was picked was Shown of Blood and Bone. And I'm glad it was picked because after reading it, I thoroughly enjoyed it. Funnily enough, this book was actually already bought as a film before the book was even published. And it's funny when we read like the acknowledgments at the end and talking about stuff and saying that like she's thanking people involved in the film. And it's kind of funny because this is the hardcover of the book. So it's not like it's like a paperback edition later on where they're like looking back at it. It's kind of funny to see that much success before it's even published. But, you know, it's because this is, you know, it's a great idea. You know, it's featuring like, you know, all, you know, black characters and also like other colored characters. Like there's no, I don't know if there's any like white people in the story. And I think there's some like other foreigners. I don't think they were white. But I mean, you don't really normally see something like that. And I think that, you know, it will be easily transformed into a movie because the one thing I didn't love about the book is that it kind of likes to jump from place to place. And I think that what works better in a movie because like they can kind of like move the plot along and, you know, show everything in like a two and a half hour movie. And I think, you know, unlike most fantasy novels, which would be so hard to make into a movie, I think Shown of Blood and Bone could make a pretty good movie. But this book follows this main character called Zaylee Adebola, and she is the daughter of a magi. And before the beginning of the book, like a couple, like a decade earlier, there was this raid that occurred. And, you know, they're all, like, they're people that, there are a certain amount of people that they're called magi, and they have white hair, and that's like it shows the magic flowing in their blood, their connection to the gods, and that when they each one kind of when they have that hair, usually they have some sort of power, you know, like kind of like X-Men mutant sort of power a little bit, but a little bit different. But you know, like they have healer, they have like she is a reaper that can like call in the spirits of the dead, use them to attack or also help them pass on to the next life or whatever, pass on to heaven. And they have like flamers that they, you know, they can spew flame, and they have like plague people that can like spread sickness. You know, there's like things, the mental ones that can like go into your dreams and like and shock you and like and you know, freeze you kind of. And you know, there's a lot of like different things. But then the one, the king, kind of in their new raid, like he is, something happens where no one can use magic, like their connection to the gods is severed. And then while this happens, the king goes around with all of his soldiers and kills every magi. And he leaves, you know, the people that aren't, you know, the children, anyone that's above the age of like 13 is and is a magi is killed. So like you get the Zele is her mother is killed, and you know she has to, you know, and now like after that they're kind of like you know, they no longer have their magic, and they also are kind of being targeted by their policies, like they're being overtaxed and they're like having to live in the slums and they're having trouble getting, like, you know, really they're, you know, they're being oppressed. At the beginning of the book, Zaylee and her brother Tithane, like they have to kind of shoved in a thing where like they like kind of accidentally save this princess that's running away after she witnesses something horrible her father does, and then they're now on the run and they're carrying this artifact which like awakens the powers of the Magi, and they're being chased by the prince Inan, and they have to get away and try to bring back magic to all the people. And it's a good way to start a story, you know. It's a lot of fun. But I think I will say that for a fantasy book, this is like young adult fantasy. Like, and I'm a big fan of fantasy books, and I've read a lot of them. And I think that one thing you really love is that you get time to kind of breathe in this world. Like, you kind of, like you get to witness what this different world is like. And I once, and that's the biggest problem I had with this book, is that I would have loved more time just to be in this world. Like, you, in the beginning, you start out and you almost immediately start on the adventure. Like, I would have liked, you know, a couple of days of them just, like, seeing what their life is like in this. And the same with, like, you have three different main viewpoint characters. You have, you know, Zelay, and you have Amari, the princess, and you have Inan, the prince. And for some reason, Tisane is not a viewpoint character. I guess he doesn't really have to anything to offer. You kind of need to see those three characters' viewpoints to get different viewpoints on everything that's happening in the story. And it does it well. Like, at a certain point, it becomes like, you know, Romeo and Juliet sort of thing. You know, star-crossed lovers. And some of the stuff is a little forced, but at the same time, it works. Like, it's angsty. I mean, the book is full of angst. And I know some young adults that are angsty will love this even more because of that. And I enjoyed it, but it does get a little too much at times. But, you know, I like that, you know, they're all kind of have, you know, horrifying pasts. And they, you know, their past kind of affects their future and, you know, what they want to do. They you know, want to bring back magic, or they want to prevent magic, they want to kill magic. And the different characters have different motivations, and it works. I also really like that there's a strong use of metaphor where, I mean, if you read it, like, it's not really heavy-handed at all. Like, you could read it and not really see that much of the metaphor. Or you can read it and you see all the metaphor in it, and it really kind of strengthens the story, and it brings it into our world in a very interesting way, because you know the Magi, they are very dark, and they also have white hair, but that, you know, that's more the fantasy thing, but then like the ruling class, they have much lighter, you know, caramel skin, copper skin. And that they, like, when you see, you know, Amari, the princess, kind of with her mother and with his other noble, like, they're, like, discussing skin treatment. Like, the queen says something like, oh, you look so regal right now. You have to share your skin treatment with us. And I bet the idea that the other girl was bleaching her skin or something to look whiter and then more regal. They considered that, like, lighter to be more regal. And it was a really interesting take on that. And then you also have this whole idea of them, you know, getting their powers back. Like, I almost think that it kind of could be a metaphor, you know, for the Black Lives Matter movement. And almost like that they're taking back their power, and like, you mean like the power to protest, and that, you know, should they protest? Should they protest violently? Should they answer violence from cops killing young black men? Should they answer that with more violence? Or, you know, should they not be violent? And I think that there's a lot of things you could look in this and you could examine. And but it also works as just a fantasy young adult story, too. You know, it works on multiple levels. And it's, I think, really expertly done with that parts of it. And I enjoyed a lot of this book. Like, it reads well. Like, it has a good flow to it. And, you know, like most young adult books, it's an easy read. You know, like, you can blast through this pretty quickly. And, like, if you're used to, like, you know, more adult fantasy books, like, or any kind of book, you know, it's an easy, fun read. And I think, you know, the world building is, I like the world building they do. I could have seen a little bit more, but I think a lot of what they did is really good. And some of the stuff is a little hand-wavy, but I mean it's okay for a young adult book. I don't mind that. And again, I like the how the romances develop. And I think the only thing I will say is that they're kind of like they go, I hate you, I love you, I hate you, I love you, I hate you, I hate you, I love you, I hate you. And like at a certain point, they really hate each other, and then they kind of there's like a meeting of the minds, and they kind of think, oh, maybe you're not too bad, or maybe you're not too bad, and they kind of like start falling in love. I think that like where it actually turns is a little too quick, but I mean at the same time, they have to bring in the romance, and it works well. And I like that he's that you don't know whether like Anand the prince whether he's like. Whether he's evil or whether he's like a villain, that a lovable villain, or whether he's like an anti-hero, you don't know what kind of role he's gonna play. And I like that for him. And they have a very arch bad guy in this one, as the King Saren that committed the raid that killed all the people. And that, but he has, I like that he has a backstory for why he did this. Like his first family and his father were all killed by flamers. And so he hates all the magi and he wants to get rid of magic and kill everyone so that they can never happen again. But also at the same time, he's horrible to his second family. His two kids, he makes them fight him when they're young. He made them fight each other, and they're scarred and they have mentally and physically. And I like a lot of things they did with him. I wish that he wasn't quite so arch. Like if there was a little bit more to him, like when the son like talks to him. I wish there was a little bit more there. But I understand that he has a role to play and he plays it well. I feel like the book slightly overuses torture. Like there are multiple torture scenes in the book, and I feel like one is really important for the story, and I understand why they did that one. But the others, they seem like too quick, and they're just like used to move the plot along. Like there's like a couple of mistaken things going on, and like they torture like some of the main characters torture other characters, and some of the main characters are tortured by other characters, and it feels like they could have gotten the same result without that happening. It's because like when I look at like how you do a torture scenes effectively, I look at like a book like The First Law, from Joe Abercrombie, where one of the main characters is a torturer, and that's more of like a clinical look on it. And another one I say is the Fitz and the Fool series from Robin Hobb, and that's Fitz. Like he is tortured and he tortures some people. And I think that that one is so effective because when it happens, when he's tortured, that kind of changes his character forever. And that like he is forever changed by that. And like it's and there's a lot of interesting things too, like with how like torture works and like how it like and what it does. And also when he tortures someone later, like it changes how everyone looks at him because they can see that he can do something like that. And in this one, a character does it, and it's just like, oh, okay, you're fine. Like, it just goes on like nothing happened. And it's like, I think it's too hand washy. Like, it's like, I think there has to be more to it. Like, if you're going to use torture, you should be more careful with it or do more with it than this does. And I also think that if you're squeamish or if you don't like, scenes like that, you may be turned off a bit when you get through them in the book. Like, I think it's not enough that I wouldn't recommend it, but I think that if you're a little squeamish, you may be really turned off by those parts of the book. It also has a problem where, like, because they're jumping all over the place, like you kind of like are traveling a lot of like days and you kind of skip over them. I would have liked to see the character development a little bit more, like in those in-between scenes. I would have liked to see more of that stuff while they're traveling, but I understand why you didn't. You want to keep it like moving. And the other thing is that they have the tendency to go somewhere new, meet some new people, and then the people are killed. You go somewhere new, meet some people are killed. Go somewhere new, meet some people are killed. And it's like, you get to a point where like you introduce a new character, then like I don't really want to care about them because they probably won't survive. And I understand again why they did it, but I think that is they could if like for this is the first book of a trilogy, and I really like this one because it does have a strong beginning, middle, and end. And I think that like it almost works as a standalone, even though like there's a little bit of a cliffhanger at the end, but like it's more like it a lot of the story threads are tied, but then they also have a setup for the next books, and I think that really works well. But you know, I hope that in the next books they don't they keep doing that. They don't keep using that, you know, to move the story along. I hope that they have introduced more side characters and have them there through the whole books. But you know, I definitely would recommend this. Like, really, it's like meant for young adults. But I think this could be read by everyone. Like, I mean, it's a really enjoyable book, and I think you know, Jimmy Fallon and the fans of Jimmy Fallon, which I am one, they chose a great first book for the first book club, and you know, this Tonight Show Summer Reads. Like, it is a really good book that I would recommend. Like, I probably give it like an 8.5 out of 10. Like, I enjoyed it a lot. But thanks for watching. You can check out other video playlists around my head. You know, I do movie reviews, TV reviews, and book reviews. And you can subscribe to me on that Z over there. Thanks for watching.